Greetings, everyone. This is Michael again, and welcome back to the channel here on YouTube. Well, this is my thoughts on the season finale of the CBS All Access series Star Trek Picard. And speaking of cards, I wrote a lot of stuff on this one. I mean, it's all over this guy. It's all over it. And even on the back, I wrote stuff. I try to keep these videos short, but it never works out that way. And I gotta say, guys, you know, if you're looking for a detailed plot analysis breakdown of the final episode, you will not get that here. There are many videos out there done very, very excellently. So I would suggest you check those out for that type of analysis. All I do is sit back in my chair, watch the episode, write my thoughts down on things that make me kind of go, I give first impressions, I give observations, and honestly, that's about it. Now, we're going to start this off, guys, and I'm going to try to get through this as fast as I can, but, you know, I try it every time, but it ends up just taking a while. And I bought me a drink here, guys, because I really think I'm going to need this when I go over this stuff. But anyway, the final episode in Star Trek Picard's first season wrapped up this past Thursday. I'm always late on these things because I genuinely had my reservations about the show. I never really felt like, at least after watching Discovery, that it was really going to be my kind of Star Trek. Which Discovery proved that it wasn't my kind of Star Trek. Discovery left a bad taste in my mouth, actually. And I gotta say that when this final episode of Star Trek Picard came on, and the first thing you see is Michael Burnham standing on some alien planet holding a flag, pretending that she's Neil Armstrong with the American flag standing on the moon, I just kind of got a little chuckle out of that. I just thought, okay, this is the fucking strangest promo for an upcoming series I've ever seen. Michael Burnham standing on an alien world holding a flag all full on herself. But anyway, that's neither here or there. But we're going to get to my list. And sometime the list is in no particular order following the plot of the story. But, you know, I'm all over the place, guys. I'll try to keep the yelling at a minimum. But what I will say before this is that, you know, the show has pretty much become what I thought it would become. It's not intelligently written at all. And as a matter of fact, a lot of it is just plain silly and stupid. But anyway, the first thing I got on my notes is the Gollum body. By that I mean, you know, Dr. Soon created this alien Gollum, this empty shell of a synthetic that's just sitting there all empty and, you know, it's serving in no purpose. But it's like, you know, this episode had so many moments in it where you would have to be totally freaking stupid to not realize the points they're setting in place that are going to be filled by the time this episode is complete. There was no thinking in this movie. There was no figuring out anything. Everything was right there in your face, and you knew exactly what was going to happen when you watched this episode. For one thing, when you saw the empty synthetic sitting there, your first thought is, well, you know, let's see. Empty synthetic shell. Why would they be showing us that? What's the point of that? Why are they even showing it to us? Well, let's see. We got a character here with a syndrome going on that's going to be, you know, it's going to die. It's the season finale, so he'll probably die in that episode, and we'll probably put him in that body. But that's neither here or there. So let's continue. Next, and I need my glasses, guys. I'm kind of nearsighted. Narek and Narissa. You know, I don't know what this show is trying to do, really, because, I mean, it feels like, you know, if there's not a cuss word in each show, then it's not a show. We've got to have a cuss word. And in this one, you know, Narek escapes from the synthetic encampment. Actually, he's let go, but we'll call it escapes. And he runs to the Borg cube that crashed on the planet as well, along with Rios' ship. And so he ends up meeting his sister in the cube, who's been hiding out there the whole time this is going on. And her first words to him is, "Did you find them? Did you fuck any of them?" And I'm just like, where the fuck did that come from? You fucking crash landed on a planet and you're worried about who your brother is fucking? I try to wrap my mind around what these people are doing in these movies, guys, and I just can't do it. I can't do it. I mean, why is she so fucking worried about who her brother is fucking? I mean, you know, you've all, well, some of you all have had sisters. If your sister kept asking you about who you're fucking, wouldn't you think that's kind of weird? It come down to the point where, sis, we have to have a talk. This is just getting a little bit out of hand. I mean, you know, who I'm fucking is none of your concern. And, you know, I was going to let it slide and not say anything, but when you crawled up into my bed and, you know, your face is about this far from my face and you're giving me all kinds of sexual innuendos and looks, I'm becoming just a little bit concerned. So I don't know why that was even included in this episode, because it really amounted to nothing, because he didn't even answer the question. And so for her to be so concerned about who her fucking brother's penis is going into, that's just weird to me. Just very, very odd. And once again, it served no purpose. It served no purpose in this story, because it already had been established that, you know, she's a little bit on the weird side, wondering who her brother's sleeping with. I mean, you know, I seriously doubt that if I'm in a ship and it crash lands on an alien planet of a race of, you know, beings that I think is going to annihilate everybody, I'm not going to give a rat's ass about who somebody's fucking. They could be laying there right in front of me fucking, and I wouldn't give a shit. But anyway, let's move on, guys. Ah, the magic gizmo. Yeah, the magic gizmo. I'm referring to the device that is given to the humans by the synthetics. This device, apparently, you know, the synthetic says something like, human says, "What is it?" And the synthetic says, "Use your imagination." So, you know, Rios' ship is crash land on the planet, and, you know, there's not very many scratches on it. Don't look like there's very much damage on it. But apparently it has no power and nothing's working on it. Now, Raffi gives the device, the magic gizmo, to Rios. And he's like, "Well, what is this? What do I do with this?" And Raffi says, "I don't know. Just, you know, use your imagination." Which by that point, I'm thinking, I'm surprised Raffi hadn't drank it and made it, you know, imagine it to be a bottle of Jack Daniels or something. But she didn't drink it, so I don't know. Maybe she's on the mend. But anyway, he uses his imagination, holds it up to a conduit in his ship, and the ship is totally repaired in 10 goddamn seconds. I'm just like, my goodness. I mean, could you imagine Scotty or Geordi LaForge or even Chief O'Brien fixing something in 10 seconds with a magic gizmo? What the fuck? What's the message here? You don't work hard, boys and girls, because everything will be given to you very easily. Is that the message? You don't have to work. Your engineering knowledge, you don't need it. All you need is a magic gizmo and the shit will be fixed. No effort on your part. You don't have to do nothing. Just hold it up and say, "Repair. Repair. I imagine you to be fixed." I'm just like, writers, is that the best fucking thing you can come up to? And I do say fucking, guys, because, you know, it's a word now. We fucking is... I mean, I like saying fuck. It's one of those words. It's not a Star Trek word, but, I mean, you know, fucking, it's a... You know, sometimes I say it when I'm mad. Sometimes I say it when I'm happy. Sometimes I say it when I'm fucking. I mean, it's a cool word, but it's not a Star Trek word. And... Writers, would it be so hard to make a plausible story that makes sense with characters that are not only developed, but they have a profession, they have a skill, they're technically qualified to be on a ship? I mean, the only way to get them out of that matter is to just say, imagine it's fixed. If the fucking androids are that fucking technologically advanced, even though it didn't look like it, what the fuck do they need with building a transmitter? What the fuck do they need these super AI creatures anyway? If they're that fucking advanced, seem like they would be able to take care of their own fucking self. I mean, there's not very many people, very many races out there that can create gizmos that can just fix shit with a beam of light. And I mean, it's just fixed. What the fuck do they need with these other synthetic aliens to wipe out humans? Why can't they take care of themselves? They don't have a shield around the encampment. They don't have advanced technology in terms of ships, or they don't have any advanced weaponry. If these synthetics can create a device where you can just imagine your ship being fixed and it can be fixed, it don't sound like to me that they should need any help from any super advanced AI to protect them. Sounds like they'd be able to protect themselves. Chalk it up to bad writing, though, I guess. A plot device. I mean, you know, surely, you know, we couldn't come up with any reason as to how, you know, the humans can fix their ship. So we'll just have to make some kind of little magic wand. You know, I didn't think I was watching Harry fucking Potter, where instead of a wand, we have an electronic gizmo that fixes this shit with no explanation of how it's done. Nothing. Anybody can just pick up this thing and make it work. And the androids or the synthetics are just free to give it to strangers. Strangers that if they wanted to kill your ass, they could just aim it at you and say, cease functioning, bitch. But anyway, guys, that's just like one of the most ridiculous things that I'd ever fucking saw. Okay, this is another gripe I had. Now, Narek, after he's let go, he runs to Rios's ship. This is before he goes to the Borg cube. And he tells Rios this story. Hey, man, the synthetics are going to kill us. You know, we can spend all day fighting each other. Or in his sister's case, we can spend all day fucking each other. But these androids are going to kill us. We need to join forces. We need to fight them. We need to destroy them before they destroy us. And everybody's like, that'll work. Let's do that. Let's join together and fight them. How the fuck do you join with someone who just a few fucking minutes ago was trying to murder your entire crew and blow up your fucking ship? What the fuck, writers? I mean, let's be realistic here. Your enemy comes to you, says, we've got a common foe. Okay. Maybe you're right. Maybe we do have a common foe. Maybe we believe you. We're going to take action. But your fucking ass is going to remain here on the goddamn ship in the fucking brig. I'll be damned if I'm going to work side by side with someone who just hours ago tried to blow my fucking ass up. Do we have any imagination here? Do we have any foresight? It was very, very stupid of these fucking people to join with Narek when he was just quite literally in the last two or three episodes ago trying to kill them in every episode. Lock him up. get all the information you need, then take action. You don't drop your fucking guard and join with the guy. He's a fucking Romulan who are known for their deceitfulness, who are known enemies of the Federation, and you just join with them. I just thought that was just so fucked up. Just so totally fucked up, man. Fucking hell. Who the fucking hacks are writing this shit, man? Am I done yet? Am I done? Am I there yet? Am I done? What else did we have here? Oh. Here's another thing that, you know, you just knew this already. Just knew it already. When Agnes joined, or so-called joined, with Dr. Soon and the robots, she wanted to be their mom. She wanted to make amends for her part in killing Maddox. So, I'm going to stay here with you guys. I'm going to help perfect Maddox's technology, his experiments. I'm gonna stay here. This is where I belong. I owe this to all of you. Did any fucking body buy that shit? Or were you smart and you thought, well, we know she's not gonna betray Picard and Rios and all that. It's all a ruse. We know she's not. And you know, you write shit like this. You write down that Agnes is a traitor, that she's gonna help the robots. You write all this stuff down. You put it in the episode. And everybody watching's thinking, what the fuck? She's not going to join Soong and the robots. Well, how do you know this? Because she's a fucking star of the fucking show! Oh, goddamn, man. Just goddamn. And then when she goes in there and breaks Picard out of his confinement, you're thinking, oh, they want to wipe out all the humans in existence. Why are they even imprisoning Picard? He's flesh. He's a human. Just kill him. And if you're not going to kill him, put fucking guards outside the fucking door. All she had to do was fucking walk into the room, grab his arm, and lead him out. And they got all the way back to the ship. 94-year-old Picard trekked through the desert. Walked all the way back to the ship. Stupid, guys. This is so infuriating because it is just written so stupidly and fans just chew this shit up. I mean, I chew it up like it's a fruit stripe gum. It's like, ooh. Flavor's there for a second, then it's gone. This is the dumbest fucking shit I have ever seen. It is so dumb. Dumb. There's no kind of sensors in the room. There's no sensors on the door that alert them that the door's been opened, that he's locked in. There's no fucking shit. What the fuck? No video monitors. Nobody's watching him. Just fucking nothing. 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 They just should have just let him go. I mean, you know, things are pretty lax if Agnes can rescue you. Anyway, and what's the deal with Admiral O? I mean, you know, this lady's leading an invasion, an attack force on a Romulan fleet, 218 ships. I mean, what does she do? How does she get out of Starfleet? How does she organize all this shit? I mean, is it like, let's see, Thursday, mobilize fleet, Friday, buy sanitizer. Saturday, leave for the synthetic homeworld. I mean, Starfleet, man. Starfleet. Starfleet's a joke. A fucking joke, man. Infiltrated by a fucking Romulan. Starfleet's a fucking joke, man. Wow. What else we got here, guys? I don't even want to finish this list, but I mean, you know, this is going to go for a while. I'm trying to get through this. And Sutra. Sutra. What the fuck is up with Sutra? You have a compound with synthetic people. Why is Sutra fucked up? Why is she evil like this? Why is she so vastly different from every fucking synthetic being on this compound? Why? What makes her different? Why? There's no excuse given. There's no fucking reason given as to why she is so conniving, why she's evil, why she would kill her own. Why? What motivations does she have? All we get is soon finding out that she did it and she's turned off. We learned absolute goddamn fucking nothing about her motivations. And I mean, why is she like this? Dr. Soon, you made the bitch. And if you made her, I would assume that you know her character traits. When the android ended up getting, or when the synthetic ended up getting killed, I mean, maybe you had an idea that Sutra could have done it? I mean, I just don't see the point of introducing a character who's vastly different from all the other characters on the planet, and, you know, you just wipe her out. No explanation, no nothing. I mean, no fucking reason given as to why this bitch is crazy. You know, something small like, well, her matrix is a little bit different. You know, we try to indue in her that, you know, kindness and consideration and all these traits. But, you know, her programming rejected it. Nothing. There's nothing. We learned nothing about her. That, what a wasted opportunity, in my opinion. Just a waste. A fucking waste. Wow. I'm on the other side, guys. Let's see. What is this? I can't even believe I wrote this. Oh, yeah. Yeah, this is just something that just, you know, I just didn't get it, really. I couldn't figure it out. When Narek and Rios and Raffi and all those stormed the compound, how the fuck were they able to beat up the synthetics in hand-to-hand combat? What? I mean, I'm gonna assume that, you know, given that we've seen Soji and her sister kick all kinds of ass, jump meters and meters into the sky, bang on the hull of a ship and bust it open, how the fuck can the humans beat these synthetics in hand-to-hand combat? Stupid! Stupid, stupid! I mean, we can cry and say, well, you know, maybe all the androids aren't strong. Well, why the fuck not? And if that's the case, why weren't we told in the story? Makes no goddamn sense that humans would be able to just waltz in there and kick ass with their fists. Stupid, stupid, stupid. I did enjoy 7 of 9 and Narissa's catfight. I mean, it was kind of sexy. I mean, you know, there's nothing better than seeing two sexy women duke it out. So that was okay. Okay. The magic tool. Yeah. Picard and Agnes take off on Rios's ship, get it up in space, and to stall for time, because Picard believes that the Federation will be there with a fleet of ships, he decides to stall for time by using the magic tool and making, like, many, many copies of Rios' ship to use as a diversion so that the Romulans will attack those holograms, I guess, instead of attacking the planet. Now, first of all, you know, Picard decides that he's going to go up in space and distract this thing. And I'm sitting there thinking, what the fuck are you doing, Picard? You don't even fucking know if the Federation is coming. You said that in an episode. You haven't been able to reach them. How do you know that they're coming? What is the point of going up into space to distract and buy time when you don't know if they're coming and you don't know when they're gonna get there? What the fuck, Picard? Fucking hell! That would have made great sense, total sense, if you knew 100% that the Federation was coming, but you didn't even fucking know! Okay. The best part of this entire episode, and I know you all thought that I was going to say the ending, and this is tied for the best part, but I'd have to say it was seeing Captain Riker. Were you seeing just a semblance of Star Trek The Next Generation? Captain Riker. That was cool. But, moving on. Now, to no surprise, Picard ends up dying. His syndrome attacks the brain, and just like clockwork, he dies in the season finale. But don't mourn, because in 5 fucking minutes, he's right back. 5 minutes. The man dies for 5 minutes, and he's back. You know, I always thought that, you know, if they were going to kill him, maybe they should have just let him die at the end of this episode, and then let it carry through to the beginning of the next season. You know, let the people mourn. Let this dilemma gestate in your audience. But no, of course not. You know, people want to be satisfied now. They want it right now. So let's kill off Picard and bring him back in 5 minutes. And where? How did they bring him back? Well, remember that empty shell of a synthetic? That's how they brought him back. And, you know, honestly, when he died, I just kind of thought, well, you know, he died doing something noble. You know, he got what he was there to do. Everything worked out. Just let him die. I would have been cool with that. Just let him die. But no, they brought him back. They brought him back, and they removed the syndrome in his head. He wasn't going to die. He's not going to die of that. But they brought him back as a fucking 94-year-old man looking exactly the way he looked when he died. I don't know about you guys, but if I fucking die and I'm 90 and I get brought back, I'm gonna be very fucking pissed if you bring me back at 90. Fucking hell. What fucking sense does that make? If you're gonna bring somebody back at 94 years old, you might as well let them fucking die. Stupid, 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 stupid. What is the point? What is the goddamn point? Picard comes back and he's just totally okay with it all. Just okay. Am I going to live forever? Well, I'd give you about 5 or 10 years before old age takes over and you succumb to it. Oh, okay. Well, good. I thought I was going to live forever. You fucking idiot. I mean, riddle me this. I remember a line from Star Trek Generations where Picard was talking to Soren. And they were talking about the human condition. And Picard said something like, "It's our mortality that defines us. It's part of our existence." He had accepted the fact that human beings get old. They die. It's a part of what we are. It's something that defines our existence. He fucking dies. They bring him back. None of that. You know, he's just like, oh, okay. You know, he looks happy. Ooh, yeah. Ooh, he even fixed that. It works. Nothing. Nothing. I don't know what to say, guys. I couldn't make this shit up if I wanted to, man. Positronic data. During Picard's death, I guess he's in purgatory or the netherworld or in between crossing over or whatever. He has this conversation with Data. Fans have gone crazy. Oh, Data got closure. Picard got to tell him that he loved him. Oh, this just makes up for Star Trek Nemesis. Data's death has meaning now. No, it don't. It don't have any fucking meaning because it's not fucking Data. If I die and you take out a little bit of my brain, it's not going to be me. I'm dead. I'm dead! You can't clone Data! Data was who he was. He wasn't a part. He wasn't a small energy speck. Or whatever the fuck a positron is, it's not Data. You can't have that little bit of what the fuck they have and call it Data. Fans need to get that. It is not Data. I don't know who the fuck Picard was talking to on that couch, but it wasn't Data. You guys need to accept that. It was not Data. Data died in Nemesis. He blew up into 1,000 particles. That was our Data. Not this fucking show that has Data in it. That's not Data. And I'm done. I'm done. I've said enough about cloning Data. It's not Data. It's a cheap knockoff. It's something to placate you fans who want to give more of a meaning to Data's life. Sometimes there isn't any more meaning. He did what he did. He sacrificed himself and it was done and over. And finally, guys, I just want to say, stupid is as stupid does. I mean, it all ends up so happily. Picard's back. The ban on synthetics is lifted. Agnes and Rios share a kiss. Seven of Nine and Raffi hold hands. When the fuck did that happen? No character development, no romance, no courtship. Seven of Nine is just playing fingers with Raffi. Fucking hell, I just give up, guys. I just fucking give up on this shit. I don't understand how people can just accept this shit, but okay. Okay. Star Trek retard.